James Blair, a Scottish-Irish MP, owned 1,598 slaves in British Guyana. When slavery was abolished in 1833, he was awarded £83,350 in compensation, a sum worth £65 million today. In total, the British government paid out today's equivalent of £16.5 billion to compensate some 3,000 families that own slaves for the loss of their so-called property and investment. It represented at the time 40% of the Treasury's annual spending budget. The sum was so large that it took British taxpayers 182 years to pay off. Taxpayers, like the children of Windrush, who were invited to Britain from Commonwealth countries in 1948. The children of the very slaves that James Blair owned. The children of people who had their British identity thrust upon them centuries ago, when they were stolen from their homes and sold as property. When it was revealed that hundreds of the Windrush generation had been wrongly detained, deported, left destitute and made homeless by the government. Originally, the expectation was that the Home Office would distribute somewhere between 200 million and 570 million to victims of the Windrush scandal. But just £62,000, 198, has been paid out to 36 people from the Home Office compensation pot. These are people who've been denied a lifetime of employment, housing, citizenship, wealth and opportunity. Many of the victims are still heavily in debt. Take Glenda Cesaire, who came to Britain legally as a three-month-old child in 1961 from Dominica. She was sacked from her job in a GP practice and then denied welfare while she remained unemployed. How did the Home Office arrive at a compensation fee of only £22,664? Was this meant to cover the loss of earnings over 10 years, the impact on family life, and the distress caused by being wrongfully detained? For so many people, these petty payouts have been nothing short of insulting, degrading, and shameful. What does this tell Windrush citizens? It tells them that the British state is more likely to compensate the descendants of slave owners than the descendants of slaves. That the British state is more likely to reimburse those who made a living displacing human beings in the 19th and 20th century than those they continue to displace in the 21st. That they live in a country that thinks the loss of profit from colonialism is more regrettable than the continuation of colonialism itself. We still don't know how many people were wrongly detained and deported. What we do know is that only 3% of Windrush claimants have so far received compensation. This is a national disgrace. Every day an injustice is not rectified constitutes a new injustice in itself that is committed. At least 11 people have died before they received any compensation. How many more will the government let die in the hope that the outrage dies with them? The Windrush citizens can never be repaid. There is no financial settlement that will restore the dignity that was stolen from them. There is no amount of money that will reverse years of pain from family separation. And there is no reimbursement that will rectify state-sanctioned brutality. But the government seems to think that the appropriate response to this is to absolve themselves of any responsibility to compensate altogether. The Windrush victims deserve much more than the mere crumbs from one of the most grievous scandals in this country's modern history. At the very least, the government should show black British citizens as much remorse as was given to those that enslaved their ancestors. That will be the beginning of a long process of national self-reflection, repentance and justice.